Good morning and happy Sabbath to everybody. I hope you had a pleasant night's rest. I can't say that I did the same. When you have the privilege and opportunity to talk about God, that brings a serious perspective to you in making sure what am I to say and how am I to say it. So as much sleeping as I did last night, I did even more meditating about how to do things. Like I said, I did some soul searching last night, and the concern here is for me, if this camp meeting wasn't for anybody else, I think it was for everybody, but this camp meeting, if it wasn't for anyone else, it was for me. I am encouraged, renewed, regenerated at this precious and dear subject that leads to life everlasting and the opportunity to grasp these things, and the wonderful speakers and mentors who came to give us the wisdom that we need, the precious manna from heaven that we need, that we will be able to seize and grasp this opportunity. The subject today is Abide in Me, and I am talking about our Christ, our Lord and Savior, Jesus. I really enjoyed it. Perfection. Think about it. How many times have we meditated on it over the last few days? Perfection. It's not a difficult subject, though people tend to make it difficult, but it is a subject that needs a lot of meditation, and we need to prioritize, because what we're really talking about is being with Christ, who is the very epitome of what? Perfection. And so we are encouraged that we would understand and know him. I want to start on the scriptural journey in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 7. Probably don't even need to turn your Bibles to it, but let's do it anyway. And beginning with verse 5, it tells us this: trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. Let's stop right there. I know I said 5 through 7, but let's stop there. What would trust in the Lord with all thine heart and leaning not unto thine own understanding? What do you think that would lead to? What is it all about?
Utter dependence.
And trust in God. It leads us to be in one, in communion, or unity, or one with God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. What do you think would happen in us if we did that? And I'm not being accusatory. I'm not saying that you don't already do that. But if we do that, If we trusted in the Lord with all our heart and leaned not unto our own understanding, what would happen?
We would be in God's will.
And when we are in God's will, what?
We're trusting His ways are right.
Mm-hmm. And if we do all of this, what state are we in?
Holy render.
Mm-hmm. In the state of holiness, in the state of perfection. Everybody's right. Everybody can come to the head of the class. Verse 6, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. What do you think would happen if that is happening in us now? The same answer. You come to the head of the class again. You gave that answer. And you're giving it again in that next verse, that verse 6. It says the same thing. If we are not, quote unquote, in ourselves and Christ in us, what state of mind are we in? What state of mind are we in? If we are not in our own minds and in all our ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. And the question is asked, is he directing our paths? Verse 7, be not wise in thine own eyes, fear the Lord, and depart from evil. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. In other words, how many of us have ever asked the question, Lord, make me what you desire for me to be? In this process of perfecting, we are being made into what? We need to be. We're being made. Let's go back over the title for just a second in the first paragraph. It says, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. His wisdom. Neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understandeth and knoweth me, that I am the Lord, which exercise loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. So what are we doing in striving for perfection? We are learning and knowing who?
Christ.
We are learning and knowing him. And this is a what? Daily, I don't want to use the word duty. This is a daily inspiration to us.
Necessity.
Yes. I was looking the other day, and they were talking about racing, and they were talking about running marathons and what happens, you know, achieving the goals of running the marathon. And in achieving those goals, when we see that runner in that race, it's not what we see, it's what we don't see. We don't see every day what he's doing. We don't what she's doing. We don't see every day how they are practicing. We don't see them running day after day after day and hour after hour, every day getting ready for the race. All we see is that race. And then the next thing you know, somebody says, I want to run a marathon, I want to get in it. But you better know what you're getting in.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So it's not what we do on special occasions or special circumstances, but it's what we are doing every day, so that when those occasions and circumstances come, we are so familiar with it, we don't know, in a sense, how to not do it. Marathon runners, in a sense, don't know how to not run marathons. And we, as Christians, we are to be in that perfecting process every day in such a way as we don't know any other way to be.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. That's what we ought to be doing every day and every hour. It should be second nature to us, or in a sense, first nature to us. It should be so ingrained in us that we don't know, in a sense, just like I just said, how to not do it. Now we go on. I want to use this scripture for a second. Philippians chapter 4. Verse 8. And while we're turning there, I think about the verse, as a man thinketh in his heart. What is he?
Yes.
As a man thinketh in his heart.
So is he.
So in the living of our lives and ingraining these things and what we've learned and shared and measured during these few days, we are what we've heard, we are what we've studied, and we are what we do every day. We don't think about walking or going up and down steps. We don't look and see if I can gingerly get to that next step, Or when we're walking, we don't think about, I'm going to put my right foot out there. I'm going to put my left foot out there. I'm going to get a rhythm to it and a speed to it. We don't think about it. We just what?
Do it.
We just do it. And when it comes to the state of mind that we have, the more we practice it, the more we just do it. And after a while, we won't even think about it because there will be nothing else for us. And we will just do it. Now, are you over at Philippians?
No.
Chapter 4. And verse 8. Let's read it together. It says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Now, what will thinking on these things get you?
Peace.
What else?
Joy.
Joy. What else?
Closer walk.
What else?
Rest.
Rest. What else?
Direction.
All these are right answers. What else?
By beholding, we become changed.
Mm-hmm. Changed into what?
Those things that are true.
Into his image. Into his image. And when we are changed into his image, we will have obtained what?
Perfection.
Next verse.
Those things, which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me do, and the God of peace shall be with you.
Amen.
In other words, you will obtain that state of perfection. Now, next question. How badly do you want it? If you study the sports world any, do you know what those people go through? I've heard some of the stories about what they go through, what they've done. In any season, it doesn't get too hot, quote unquote. It doesn't get too cold. It doesn't get too wet. It doesn't get too dry. When we see them, or if we look at them perform, when we see them, it is a sum total of what they've been over a season or a year or whatever. They didn't get out there at the last minute and just do it. They are just constantly at it because, in a sense, in their world, they want to be what?
Perfect
in what they do. What do we want? What price are we willing to pay? Who is it and what is it that we are unwilling to let go of that we might obtain this state? Have we ever thought about it? Who is it in your life and what is it in your life that you would be unwilling to let go of to obtain perfection? And I ain't talking about them folks that are easy to get rid of. Somewhere that is distinctive in another way, another gender, another culture, whatever. I'm talking about folks that are near and dear to you. You know what I'm saying?
Amen.
Near and dear to you. How near and how dear to you are they? And are they so dear and so near that Christ has no place or no part that cannot get there with you because there's somebody in the way that is, quote unquote, near and dear to you? Who is it and what is it that you will refuse to let go of to obtain perfection? What means more to you? And by perfection, what am I talking about? Because we said it here this morning. By perfection is being in Christ and Christ being in us. And I think one of the speakers before today talked about abiding. Who is it and what is it that we would refuse to let go of to abide in Christ? How important is he to us? I think about a flawed woman named Mary Magdalene and how she came to know him and how she came to feel about him. That in all things, in all seasons, she had not only was willing, had let go of everything and everybody but who?
Jesus.
All that was on her mind was who?
Jesus.
Nothing else, and nobody else meant what? Anything to worth her, because she had had that personal experience, that mercy, that compassion, that genuineness, that spiritual embrace in such a way that it affected her in such a way that whatever her Lord and Savior was going through. She wanted to be right there. She got it. But many of those who should have got it didn't get it. Now I ask us today, do we get it? Does our life say, I got it? I talked to a doctor friend of mine, and he talked about his experience in medical school and all the struggles that he had. And he said one day, sitting in a room in a university, all that he was doing, what it was about, whatever, all of a sudden, he said he got it. Whatever it was, he figured it out. And now he understood medicine and the practice of medicine. All of a sudden, the light came on. And he got it. So I'm asking us today, has the light come on, and do we get it? Does our life say that we got it? In the process of being perfected, it's like climbing a mountain. Now you know in climbing a mountain, you don't climb, quote unquote, straight up it. If you know anything about mountain climbing, sometimes you have to go laterally, and sometimes you even have to go down to go up. Mm-hmm. Now some of you folks, how many of you in here have been hiking? Do you always go just straight to the point where you want to go?
Not in West Virginia.
But you got a little lateral movement there sometimes, right? You got to go up some, but sometimes you got to come back down to go back up. Yep. And what am I talking about? The human experience is not smooth. You don't just go right through life. Life has its what? Hills and valleys. Mm-hmm. There is all kinds of temptation. There's all kinds of problems or troubles. But I think I heard somebody mention something about the angel, Jacob, and wrestling with him, and that pain that he went through. He was being tested, right? In this season we call living, we are being tested that we would what? I'll speak it again in a minute. That striving that Paul talked about and that pressing toward the mark. And in doing those things, it is sometimes not easy. Painful, hurtful, anguishing things happen in our lives, don't they? But still we got to go on. Because we need to get to the pinnacle. We need to get to the mountaintop. How desirous are we to obtain this? How desirous? Let's look at Jeremiah 29:13. A lot of technology this week, and it's wonderful. I'm just so impressed with it. But y'all please forgive me for doing this old school. Jeremiah 29:13. What does it say? And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. I want to make sure you got it. So read it along with me. 29:13. And the ones that know it, just say it. It doesn't matter. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. It's conditional, isn't it? You're going to get out of it what you put into it. How valuable is it? What is it? What cost are you willing to pay? What sacrifice are you willing to make? Do you want it bad enough? Folks in here cook. Anybody in here cook? I'm quite sure you do. None of us is looking emaciated, so somebody's cooking. But anyway, in cooking and learning the art of cooking, is it something you just haphazardly do and learn to do it well? No. You got to put a what? In your chosen field of endeavor. How you make your living. How long would you last if you put less than your best in it?
Not very long.
We wouldn't last very long, would we? That man, my brother, right there, Alan Stump, you cannot imagine what he has put into all of what he's come to do in just a few minutes in a haphazard way. He put everything he had into it. Now, I could use an analogy. Please don't take this the wrong way. But let's say you saw some eggs on a plate. You know that that chicken made a sacrifice, didn't it? But suppose it was something else. This shouldn't be on a plate, but in a lot of places and homes, it is on a plate. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I don't need to get into the specifics, but if you saw it on that plate, you would know that the ultimate sacrifice had been paid for it to be on that plate. Now, does anybody want me to clarify that? What am I talking about? Or do you already know? When you see that on that plate, you know what. So we see, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And if you want to contribute, I invite you to, because quote unquote, I don't know it all. I want this morning's to be a shared experience. You know what I'm saying? If you have a contribution that maybe I'm not quite seeing, then share it. But let's go on. You see, hopefully each of us understands this. We are under construction. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been near a construction site? That's one of my faults. I just love seeing how stuff gets put together. I love it. I love how stuff, where it came from and how it came to be and all the mental aspects of it and putting it together and assembling it and how they accomplish whatever. I love that kind of thing. But we are under construction. We are not a finished building yet. Because when you are become a finished building, what will you have?
Perfection.
Mm-hmm. We're under construction. Now, I'm not saying you don't have it, but I'm saying we're in the process of gaining more and more of it. We might be a perfect building for 89 floors, but if it's 96 floors, we're still under construction. Am I right? And so we are still under construction, and with every day. We're growing, we're maturing, and in a sense, Paul put it best. Paul said something about dying daily. Was he talking about his flesh? No. But he's talking about dying daily. I'm glad, and I'm especially glad for this week, because some things died this week for Dennis. Amen. Some things died that needed to be dead, should have never lived.
Amen.
But they did. If we are faithful to confess our sins, he is what? And not only to forgive us, but what? To cleanse us. We are under construction. We're pressing toward the mark. We're striving to get to where we want to be. We have no right, no reason to rest on our laurels. None. But this perfecting process is a daily thing. It is an ongoing thing. I have been sitting in my own living room saying, I'm doing good here. I'm minding my business, not causing any problems or whatever. Door knock, phone rings. There we go. But I am learning surely to put them, that, those, and it in the proper order and make sure my perfecting process takes priority. You know what I'm saying? I've learned folks and things that used to let unnerve me and distract me no longer.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I got a little expression. And if they call or knock on the door or something, if they sick, call 911. If it's trouble or social problems, call the police. If they need surgery or medication, call the doctor. Mm-hmm. If they have a home problem, call a construction person. Don't call me. Now, why? That's not very nice, Dennis. There are people who can solve these problems. I'm none of those things. I'm not a paramedic, nor a doctor, all those other things. You need people who are experts in their lives. But I am not going to let you take me away from my perfecting process. I'm not going to let you take me away from thinking about the goodness of God and meditating on Him for your quote unquote petty problem. First things must come first. If you want those problems solved, take it to the same Father and Son that I am meditating on. They're the ones can solve your problem. They're the ones can give you peace. They're the ones who can reveal the answer to you who and what that answer is. You're asking the wrong one to ask me, and beside that, you're interrupting my perfecting process. Do I still care about people? Am I still compassionate? Yes. Am I still loving? But first things must come first. The more of your life you let people have, the more they will take. Think about that. The more of your life you let others have, the more they will take. Enough is never enough. Keep your priorities straight. Jesus did, even when he was a young person. And they questioned him about his disappearance or something. What did he tell them?
My Father's work.
I must be about my Father's business. I'm not saying I disrespect you as my parents or whatever, but my Father's business is number one. You survived. Didn't nothing bad happen to you? You made it okay. Other than troubling about me and worrying about me, you made it okay. You'd be surprised. I learned something about life. The same people that just think that they desperate to have you and you just got to be there. I tell you what, if you could, die and see if they die. Do you know what I'm talking about? The same people who are so urgent and you are so necessary to them and they can't live without you, die. Leave somebody behind to watch and whatever, and see if they die. Mm-mm. They'll find somebody else just like you to replace you. But they're not going to go the same way you did because you did. You no longer serve their purpose. I'm talking about the perfecting process, that it must be such a priority to us that anyone else and anything else becomes secondary. I've dealt with people so much in my life, and people are saying, oh, I just got to have it right now, whatever. And you just have to stop right now and do this for me, whatever. I wouldn't. I went back to them lately, and now what was your problem? Well, it's too late now. Well, your problem wasn't that big to start with. You just wanted to interrupt my life for your quote-unquote selfish desires. I don't know about you, but I'm getting a made-up mind. And what I'm talking about is, whoever and whatever, I will address it in its proper time, its proper way, but nothing and nobody is going to come before my perfecting process. Who is it that you want to have your salvation? Who is it? What is it that you want to have your salvation? As we've heard this week, it's been laid out there before us. And all we have to do is grasp it, take it, embrace it, whatever you want to call it. But it's been laid out there for us. One more thing about the folks in my life. It's gotten to the point is when they do, when they have the nerve, the audacity to come into my presence to bring the issue to me to address, it's a very serious issue now. It's nothing silly or foolish because they have learned you ain't gonna get him to move or do nothing based on what your priorities are. Who is the better, greater priority? Your Lord and Savior? Are your family, friends, loved ones, or whoever? Love them, but don't let them take your soul. Now, either you're tired of me saying this, or you're really doing some meditating about what I said. I hope it's the latter. But let's go on. We are under construction, our daily walk. I'm quite sure that most of us have already walked with the Lord this morning. And I'm quite sure most of us are going to continue through the day to walk with the Lord. And even at night, we're going to walk with the Lord. But I made a commitment after last night's message. I made a commitment about who and what is going to be the number one priority in my life. I'm confessing, I have let some people and things in my life get me to the point where I look at myself and say, the Lord isn't first anymore. Mm-hmm. Something is wrong. Something is dearly wrong, and this is going to stop now. Meditate with him in your private garden, talking to him, whatever. If people think you're crazy, just let them think it. But meditate with him. Let's look at Zechariah 4, verse 6. You there yet? Yes. Many, if not all of us, already know this. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, this is the really important part here. Let's read it together. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Who?
The Lord.
I'm going to say it again. Who?
The captain of our salvation.
not mama, not daddy, not brother, not sister, not even minister, a teacher, prophet. Did I leave out anybody? Not the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker, but by who?
The Lord of hosts.
Okay. And if he does it, it is what? The perfecting process that we need. That we might become what we need to be, that we might become it now for the glorification of his name and for the benefit of our souls. We need to indemnify with him. When you look at the book of John, it's just full of how he indemnified with his father. I in him and him in me.
Yes.
Can we say the same thing? I in Jesus and Jesus in me. See, I know what the problem is either way. You either don't want to get into him or you won't allow him to get into you. Jesus in us and we in him. That perfecting process will mature and come to success when we abide in him. John 14:6. The Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 6. This is what he says. Jesus saith unto him, I am the what? The way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Can you come to the Father without perfection? How are you going to obtain perfection? Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5. Can this be said of us? Paul said this. Let this mind be in you, which was also in who? Does it mention anyone else? Did it leave out some folks? No. It gave us what we what? Need. My God will what? Supply all your need. With me, all things
possible.
And without me, ye can do nothing. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That is our striving every day, or it should be. Galatians 2:20, and then this is my personal favorite. Maybe I shouldn't say it that way, but it is. Galatians. Chapter 2 and verse 20. Let's read it. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Stop. Can we say that? Each of us must examine himself, or in a sense, be examined, that we can say that. I live, but nevertheless not I, but Christ liveth in me. Next. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by what? The faith of the Son of God. It's not all about me. It's all about him. And thank God he has used me to give honor and praise and glory to his name. That's what it's about. And why? Who loved me and gave himself for me. Did he buy you? Yes. Did he pay for you? Did he redeem you? We could at least say thanks, couldn't we?
Amen.
1 Corinthians 15:31. We're getting on toward the close now. 1 Corinthians 15:31. I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. And as I told you before, a few things have died this week in me. I don't know about you, but some things have died. Thank God they did. And as I said before, they had no business living, but thank God now they're dead. A couple more verses. Philippians 3:14. Press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What is that high calling? A perfected life, perfected thoughts, perfected deeds. And last but not least, 1 Corinthians. Chapter 9. In verse 25. And verse 27. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. If you have Christ in you, will you have peace? Yes, you will. Mm-hmm. And you will be temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we are incorruptible. It matters that we do this, but it matters most why we are doing it. We got to get the why along with the will. Why are we doing it? For me, so I can glorify myself. Mm-hmm. But to glorify him, who we just got through talking about what he did for us. Now, verse 27, and it comes to a close. Thank you for the privilege and opportunity. I hope that if I not have not advanced you, that I did not hinder you. And so, but it says, but I keep under my body and bring it into what? Subjection, but rather it is Christ that if I will allow him, that brings me into subjection, because, quote unquote, I can't bring me under subjection. It is him that brings me, if I will allow him to. Lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. You get it? When I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. So in everything I've said today, be sure that I've reflected upon ourselves. I can't give you any wisdom by the grace of God or by perfection unless I allow the wisdom of God to come to me first. And so I have enjoyed it. Thank you for the privilege and opportunity. Good to be with you for another year. And let his spirit rest, rule, and abide in all of us.